Good morning to you all. Welcome to this class for chapter 2, electrostatic potential and capacitance. In the previous chapter or in the previous class, we have studied about the parallel plate capacitor and the formula for its capacitance. We have also studied the effect of dielectric in a parallel plate capacitor. In this class, we will be learning about the combination of capacitors, that what will be the equivalent capacitance when a number of capacitors are connected in series or in parallel. And then we have to find the expression for the energy density, energy stored in a capacitor, and then finally the energy density of a capacitor. So let's start with the first topic, that is the combination of capacitors. So the capacitors can be connected either in series or in parallel. So first we'll be studying about the series combination. We have to find an equivalent capacitance when a number of capacitors are connected in series. The same thing we have done in class 10 for resistors. That when the resistors are connected in series, what will be the equivalent resistance? And when they are connected in parallel, what will be their equivalent resistance? Similarly, we have to discuss it about the capacitors when they are connected in series. So let's consider this thing that there are C1, C2 and C3. Three capacitors are there and they are connected in series as shown in figure. So you can see that C1 is one capacitor, C2 is another capacitor and C3 is another capacitor. Alright, by C1, C2, C3 I mean this thing that they are the value of their capacitances. There is one capacitor that is having value capacitance C1. Similarly, for the second capacitor, the value of capacitance is C2. For third capacitor, the value of capacitance is C3. And they are connected in series, one after another. V1, V2 and V3 is the respective potential difference between the capacitors 1, 2 and 3. So across this capacitor, the potential difference is V1. Across second capacitor, the potential difference is V2. And across third capacitor, the potential difference is V3. The total voltage applied across the combination of these capacitors is capital V. And we know this thing that in series combination, the charge on each capacitor, it remains the same. Just like this, in the case of series combination of resistors, the current remains the same. In this case, in the series capacitors, series combination of capacitors, the charge will remain the same. So we can write it like this, that let V be the potential difference applied across the series combination and V1, V2, V3 be the potential differences across the three capacitors respectively. And Q is the charge that is stored on each capacitor. Because of the application of this potential difference, there is a charge Q that is stored on each capacitor. So we can write like this, that the value of this V1, that is the potential difference across capacitor 1, it can be written by this formula. V1 is equal to Q upon C1. In our previous class, we have discussed about this thing that Q is equal to CV. So charge stored on any capacitor is equal to the product of its capacitance and the potential difference across its end. Similarly, from that formula, we can find this thing that the potential difference across this capacitor, it is the ratio of charge to the capacitance. Alright, so Q upon C1 is your V1. Similarly, the potential difference across second capacitor, it will be the charge stored on the second capacitor divided by its capacitance, that is Q by C2. And for third capacitor, the potential difference will be the charge stored on capacitor 3 divided by its capacitance. So it comes out to be V3 is equal to Q by C2. Alright. And this total potential difference, that is V, applied across the combination, it is getting divided into three parts. That is V1, V2 and V3. So you can write this thing that this capital V, it is equal to V1, V2 plus V3. The total potential difference, capital V, is the sum of the individual potential differences across the capacitor. So we can write that capital V is equal to V1 plus V2 plus V3. I hope it is clear. Now, in place of V1, I can write this value, that is Q by C1. In place of V2, I can write Q by C2. And for V3, I can write Q by C3. Now the total potential difference across the combination after putting the values of V1, V2 and V3, it becomes like this. That is, capital V is equal to Q upon C1 plus Q upon C2 plus Q upon C3, and this is your equation number 1. Please solve it along with me so that you will be able to get the concept and you will be understanding it in a better way. So please draw the diagram and solve it along with me. This was the value of the total potential difference that is applied across the combination of these three capacitors which are connected in series, and we have obtained the equation as V equal to Q upon C1 plus Q upon C2 plus Q upon C3. Now, our aim is to convert this combination of three capacitors into a single capacitor so that if we apply the same potential difference across that capacitor, we'll be getting the same amount of charge that is stored in either of these capacitors. So our equivalent combination for this capacitor has to be like this. You can see that we have to replace these capacitors by a single capacitor, C equivalent, such that if we apply the potential difference, capital V across that capacitor, we'll be getting the same value of charge. So our aim is to find the equation or the expression for this C equivalent. So this was the equation that we have obtained from the previous slide, that V equal to Q upon C1 plus Q upon C2 plus Q upon C3. Now, if C equivalent be the effective capacitance of the series combination, it should acquire a charge Q when a voltage V is applied across it. And this triple sign is for equivalent. It means we need an equivalent circuit for the series combination. We need to find the value for C equivalent. From this figure, that is the figure that we have drawn for the equivalent circuit of the series combination, we can write like this, that V is equal to Q upon C equivalent. From the second figure, we can write like this, that V is the potential difference applied and Q is the charge stored on it. So the value of this capacitance for this capacitor, that is C equivalent, can be calculated like this. The potential difference V is equal to charge stored on the capacitor divided by its capacitance, that is C equivalent. Now, if from equation 1 and 2, we can write this thing that towards the left hand side, we are having the voltage V. So both these equations, they are representing the voltage V. So they are equal. We can equate them out. From equations 1 and 2, we have Q upon C equivalent is equal to Q upon C1 plus Q upon C2 plus Q upon C3. All right. And now taking the charge Q common, we can easily cancel the charge Q from both the sides of the equation. And we are left with 1 upon C equivalent is equal to 1 upon C1 plus 1 upon C2 plus 1 upon C3. So in series combinations, when a number of capacitors are connected in series, the reciprocal of the effective capacitance is equal to the sum of the reciprocals of the capacitance of the individual capacitors. Alright? So this is somewhat opposite to the resistors. And resistors, when the resistors are connected in series, for equivalent resistance, we just add all the resistors. But in the case of capacitor, we have to take the reciprocal of the individual capacitors and then we have to add them up. And then again, we need to take the inverse in order to find the C equivalent. All right. So the formula gets interchanged. The one that we have got for the parallel combination in the case of resistors, it is now the case for the series combination of the capacitor. All right. So I hope it is clear, and please write it along so that you will be able to understand in a better way. So this is the case for the series combination of the capacitors. When the capacitors are connected in series, this is how we need to find the equivalent capacitance. Now let's take the case when the capacitors are connected in parallel. So that's the second case in combination of capacitors, when the capacitors are connected in parallel. So we can see that 1, 2, 3 capacitors are there. They are connected in parallel. And the voltage source capital V is applied across the combination of these three capacitors which are connected in parallel. And when the capacitors are connected in parallel, the charge across each capacitor gets divided. They may vary. And the potential difference across each capacitor, it remains the same. Because we know this thing, that in parallel, the potential difference remains the same. So consider three capacitors of capacitance C1, C2, and C3, which are connected in parallel, as given in the figure. Capital V is the potential difference applied across the parallel combination. So across C1, the potential difference will be V only. Across C2, it will be V only. And across C3, again, it will be V only. Because when the capacitors are connected in parallel, the potential difference remains the same. The charge Q1, Q2, and Q3 is the respective charges across the capacitors C1, C2, and C3. And each capacitor, it is having the same amount of potential difference, that is V across it. We can write the charges on these capacitors by the formula Q equal to CV. So the charge that is stored on the first capacitor, that is equal to the product of the capacitance of the capacitor and the potential difference across it. So Q1 comes out to be C1V. C1 is the capacitance of this capacitor and V is the potential difference applied across this capacitor. Similarly, for the second capacitor, Q2 is equal to C2 into V. The charge stored in a capacitor is the product of the capacitance and the potential difference across it. C2 is the capacitance across capacitor second and V is the voltage across it. Similarly, for the third capacitor, Q3 is equal to C3 into V. So we can write it like this. The total charge given by this source having potential difference capital V is Q. So it is giving the charge Q and that Q charge is getting divided into Q1, Q2 and Q3. So we can write like this. The total charge on the system of the capacitor, that is Q, is equal to Q1 plus Q2 plus Q3. This Q charge is given by the source capital V. And this charge is getting divided into three parts, Q1, Q2 and Q3 across the capacitor 1, 2 and 3. Now, in place of this Q1, I can write C1V. In place of Q2, I can write Q2V, C2V. And in place of this Q3, I can write C3V. So it can be written like this. That Q, the total charge is equal to C1V plus C2V plus C3V. And this is your equation number one. We will be using this equation when we need to find the equivalent capacitance for this parallel combination of the capacitors. All right. Now we need to draw an equivalent circuit for this parallel combination of the capacitors such that all these three capacitors can be replaced by a single capacitor. So this is how we'll do it. The equation that we have obtained in the previous slide is this one. And now C equivalent be the effective capacitance of the parallel combination such that we have applied a voltage V across it. So we'll be drawing it like this. All right. So this is the equivalent circuit for this parallel combination of the capacitor and the capacitance of the equivalent capacitance is C equivalent. We need to find the value for this C equivalent. From this figure, we can write the total charge Q stored on this capacitor. It is equal to the capacitance multiplied by the potential difference across it. And that is equal to C equivalent multiplied by V. Equation 1 and equation 2, they are both equal to small q, that is the total charge supplied by the voltage V. So they are equal. We can easily be writing them equal. And then we will be finding the value of C equivalent. So equating equations 1 and 2, we can write C equivalent into V is equal to C1V plus C2V plus C3V. Taking V as common and then cancelling it out. So V can be taken out common from the right hand side equation and we can easily cancel it out. We are left with C equivalent is equal to C1 plus C2 plus C3. So by mistake, it is V is still been there. So let me correct it up. Now we are good. So this is what we have taken the voltage V common from the right hand side and then we have cancelled it out and you are left with C equivalent is equal to C1 plus C2 plus C3. All right. And this is the effective combination, effective capacitance of the combination of capacitors when they are connected in parallel. When the capacitors are connected in parallel, in order to find the equivalent capacitance, we just need to add the individual capacitances of the capacitor. All right. So this was the case of series equivalent resistance. When we were finding the equivalent resistance, when the resistance were connected in series, then we have to use this formula. But in the case of capacitors, they get interchanged. The one that we have obtained for the series combination in case of resistors, it is for the parallel combination in case of capacitors, and the one which we have obtained for the parallel combination of resistors is now for the series combination of the capacitors. All right, so that you have to keep in mind. So this is all about the combination of capacitors and how we need to proceed to find the equivalent capacitance when the capacitors are connected in series or in parallel. The next topic that we have to study today is energy stored in a capacitor, and it is denoted by capital U. All right, for small u we are having one another term that is denoted by small u, that is the energy density. But the energy stored in a capacitor, it is denoted by capital U. Let's try to find the expression for the energy stored in a capacitor. Capacitor is a device that stores charge, we know this, and in order to store some charge on the capacitor, work has to be done. We need to do some work to store the charge on the capacitor, and this work done to store the charge on the plates of the capacitor gets stored in the form of electrostatic potential energy of the capacitor, or the energy of the capacitor. Generally, we call it as energy of the capacitor. All right, so we need to find the expression for it. Let us consider that Q be the charge and V be the potential difference between the plates of the capacitor. And we are giving a small amount of charge dQ to the capacitor. All right. So we need to do some small work in order to supply this dQ charge on the capacitor. Earlier, the charge present on the capacitor was small q and capital V be the voltage across it. We need to supply a small amount of charge dQ on the plates of the capacitor, and in doing so, we need to do some work, and that small work done is dW. All right, and we know this, that if we need to do some work, work then can be given by the product of potential difference and the charge. So the potential difference across the plates of the capacitor was capital V, and the charge that you people are supplying is dQ. So the work done in supplying charge dQ, it is equal to dW, that is equal to VdQ. This we have studied. The work done is equal to the product of potential difference and the charge. The potential difference was V, and dQ is the charge that you are supplying. So the small work done in supplying charge dQ, it comes out to be V multiplied by dQ. All right. In place of this V, I can write Q by C. We know this. Q equal to CV, where C is the capacitance of the capacitor. So in place of this V, I can write Q by C. So dW, it comes out to be Q by C dQ. And the C, that is a fixed thing. Capacitance is fixed for a capacitor. We cannot change the capacitance. It is depending on the dimensions of the capacitor. Once a capacitor is made, we can't change the capacitance. We can only change the capacitance of a capacitor at the time of manufacturing. So because it is depending on the dimensions, so it is a fixed value. So we can take it out. We can, in order to find the total work done, we need to do the integration of this small work done. The total work done to charge the capacitor, that is W, is equal to integration of small work done dW, and it is from 0 to Q. So we are charging the capacitor from, once the charger, the capacitor was uncharged earlier, and now we are charging the capacitor from uncharged value, that is 0, to the fully charged value, that is capital Q. So this is the full charge value, that is capital Q. All right, so that's why the limit of the integration is from 0 to capital Q. In place of this dW, we can write Q by C dQ. All right, so the total work done to charge the capacitor, it is equal to integration 0 to Q, and in place of this dW, we have written the value Q by C dQ, that is the small work done and giving a charge dq to the place of the capacitor that we have obtained earlier. Now this c is constant, we can take it out of the integration. So taking c out of the integration, we are left with 0 to q dq. All right, now what is the integration of x dx? It is x square upon 2. We know this. So the integration of 1 upon c 0 to q dq, it is q square, the small q square upon 2 with the limit 0 to capital Q. So we can write it like this. All right, so this is what we can write. The integration of q dq, it will be q square upon 2, and the limits of this integration is 0 to capital Q. All right, now putting up the limits, first upper limit in place of the small q, first put upper limit and then one minus sign and then put the lower limit. So you are left with this thing. All right, and once you are done putting the limits, you can easily be solving it out. The total work done to store the charge capital Q on the place of the capacitor, it's come out to be Q square upon 2C. All right, when you solve it out, the value of this capital W, it comes out to be Q square upon 2C, and this is the work done to store charge capital Q on the place of the capacitor. And we know this, that the work done to store the charge on the place of the capacitor gets stored in the form of its potential energy. So we can replace this W with capital U. This work done gets stored in the form of potential energy of the capacitor. So you can write U is equal to Q square upon 2C. All right. So this is the final expression for the energy stored in a capacitor when it is charged to a charge capital Q. But in this case, we have assumed this thing that initially capacitor was uncharged. That's why we have taken the limit from 0 to Q. We have assumed that initially the capacitor was uncharged. But what is the case if capacitor was having some charge earlier and then we are giving some more charge to it? So in that case, the limits may get changed from Q naught to Q. So earlier the charge was Q naught, and then we are charging it to a value capital Q. All right. So if the capacitor is initially having a charge Q naught, then in place of this zero, I can write Q naught. Then the limits get changed from Q naught to Q. So in this expression, that is this final expression, we are left with Q square upon 2 minus Q naught square upon 2. So because you also have to put a Q naught in this, when you will be solving this in limits, you have to put Q naught out. So you are left with this expression. Q square upon 2C minus Q naught square upon 2C, and when you solve it out, you are left with this thing. So this is the expression when you are charging a capacitor to a value Q. Initially, the charge present on the capacitor was Q naught. But this is the expression of the energy stored in a capacitor when the charge stored on the place of the capacitor was zero earlier. It means the capacitor was uncharged, and you are charging it to a value capital Q. So these two expressions you need to keep in mind. Now we need to find different expressions for the energy stored in a capacitor. So this energy stored in a capacitor, it can be expressed in three ways. So let's try to derive those expressions. This was the result that we have got from the previous slide, that the energy stored in a capacitor, capital U, it is equal to Q square upon 2C, where Q is the charge stored on the capacitor and C is its capacitance. Now we can write Q equal to CV. We know this from our previous discussion. We know that the charge is equal to the product of capacitance and the potential difference. In place of this Q, I can write CV, and Q square is C square V square. Squaring this, it becomes C square V square. So you can cancel this C out, and you are left with U is equal to CV square by 2. So this is one alternate expression for the energy stored in a capacitor, that is U equal to half CV square. So sometimes we use this formula also in order to find the energy stored in a capacitor. Again, we can use this formula C equal to Q by V. So in this expression, we can use this formula. The capacitance is the ratio of the charge to voltage. So in place of this C, I can write Q by V. All right. So you can write Q by V for this C. And then one V gets cancelled out with this V, and you are left with half QV. All right. So this is one another expression for the energy stored in capacitor. So now I can say this, that there are three expressions for the energy stored in a capacitor. All right. That is given by these three things. One is Q square upon 2C. Other one is half CV square. And one is half QV. All right. So these are the three expressions that you have to keep in mind for solving up the numericals. So sometimes you will be using the first one or maybe the third one at the time. All right. So sometimes according to the question, we need to apply either of these three formula in order to find the energy stored in a capacitor. Now we need to discuss the energy density of a capacitor, and it is denoted by small u. First, I should tell you that what is the definition of this energy density, and then we'll be deriving an expression for the energy density of a capacitor denoted by small u. When the capacitor discharges, the stored up energy is released. So that's the expression that we have found out just now, that is for the energy stored in a capacitor. When a capacitor discharges, this stored up energy is released. It is possible to view the potential energy of capacitor is stored in the electric field between the plates. The question arises, where is this energy gets stored? So it gets stored in the electric field between the plates. We know this thing that for a parallel plate capacitor, that there are two oppositely charged plates are there, and in between them there lies the electric field. In that electric field, the potential energy of the capacitor gets stored up. All right. So now let's try to find out the definition for the energy density. So energy stored in a capacitor, it is this one. And energy density is energy stored per unit volume. So if you divide this capital U by capital V, that is volume, you will be getting the expression for the energy stored, energy density of a capacitor, that is small u. All right. So we need to find the expression for small u, that is the energy density. It can be defined as the energy stored per unit volume. All right. So let's try to find it out. This u is equal to q square upon 2c. We know this. And the value of this q, it is equal to sigma into a. Sigma is your surface charge density, that is Q by A. So you can write like this, that this Q is equal to A into sigma. Easily you can write it like. Now we can use the expression for capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. So for a parallel plate capacitor, the capacitance is given by epsilon naught A by D. In place of this C, I can write epsilon naught A by D. That's what I have written. All right. So in place of this C, I have written epsilon naught A by D. And since it is in denominator, when you change it with multiplication sign, you have to multiply it with D upon epsilon naught A. All right. So dividing by C means multiplying by D upon epsilon naught A. So this is your first equation. Now, the surface charge density sigma is related to the electric field E between the plates by this expression. We know this, that E is equal to sigma upon epsilon naught. Between the plates, the electric field is given by this expression, that is sigma upon epsilon naught, that we have used earlier also when we were deriving the value for the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. Now, the value of the sigma can be written by cross multiplying it. We can write it like E multiplied by epsilon naught, where E is your electric field and epsilon naught is your permittivity of the vector. So in place of this sigma, you can write E into epsilon naught. So using 2 in equation number 1, replace this sigma by E epsilon naught. So you can write it like this. U is equal to half epsilon naught E square into AD. How I have written it? Let me explain this to you. That in place of this sigma, I have written E epsilon naught. So it will be E square epsilon naught square, and one epsilon naught gets cancelled out with this epsilon naught, and one A will be cancelled out with this A. All right. So in the numerator, you are left with AD, epsilon naught E square, and half was there. Again, I am explaining it to you. In place of this sigma, I have written E epsilon naught. So sigma square will be E square epsilon naught square, and one epsilon naught gets cancelled out with the epsilon naught square in the numerator. So we are left with only one epsilon naught in the numerator. E square remains as it is. One A gets cancelled out with this A. So we are left with one A in the numerator. D was already there. So this is A into D in the numerator. And epsilon naught E square half was there already in the already was there in the equation. So we have written like this. So we are left with U is equal to half epsilon naught E square multiplied by AD, where A is the area and D is the separation between the plates. And A into D is nothing but your volume. Area multiplied by distance gives you volume. So you can write it like this. Energy density, that is small u, is the energy per unit volume. So you can write U is equal to capital U upon capital V, where V is your volume. And in place of this V, you can write AD. All right. When you take this AD in the denominator of this U, you are left with half epsilon naught E square. So this is the expression for the energy density, that is small u, for a capacitor. That is equal to half epsilon naught E square. You can see this energy density, it is directly proportional to electric field E. So now we can see that where the energy gets stored, it is stored towards the in the electric field between the plates of a parallel plate capacitor. All right. I hope I am very much clear in this one. And still, if you are having some doubts, you are most welcome to ask your questions. So that's all for today that I want to discuss with you people. And these formulae you will have to remember actually, because there will be a lot of numerical questions on these formulae. Thank you very much for joining up the class. Stay safe, stay blessed.